Going to do a short little study today on maintaining the blessed hope. Going through some real rough times right now. I've let some people know, and I appreciate the prayers of those out there that have been praying. It's just, I've gone through a lot of pain, a lot of suffering, a lot of very bad times financially, very bad times, all kinds of things. I can relate to the Apostle Paul. I haven't been beaten or put in prison yet, so I haven't done that. But there's a lot of things that have happened in my life that have been pretty negative. But one of the things that really gets to me is when I'm hindered from work. And I'm real busy, trying to get stuff done for the Lord. And it's just like some ridiculous thing comes into my life. And I'm just like, you got to be kidding me. I just got this research, and I just found this stuff. And I'm putting the sermon notes together. And I'm ready to preach it like tomorrow. And this thing happens in my life that pulls me away from preaching the Word of God. That is what gets me frustrated. That's what gets me very, very down. And we've been getting hit hard lately. And 2016 was a really notorious year for this whole thing. I mean, and as we get closer to the rapture, this stuff is only getting worse and worse. And got some stuff to say on that too coming up here. But just to let everybody know what's going on, way back before winter started here, which it starts in November, essentially, can even go into October. But, it depends on things. But it's about 6 months of winter here. Half the year. I heard somebody say recently, they said, we don't have winter in Aroostook County, Maine. We have a six-month commitment. So I thought that was pretty good. But I bought a snowblower. And I thought, okay, this is going to speed things up. I won't have to go out and lane and shovel things and whatever. And so I was all happy. It was a Honda snowblower. It was a good one. I bought it used, about half the price of a new one. I mean, they were very expensive. And so we got a real good deal, things like in new condition. Really, really did a good job early on. And all of a sudden, it's just like the thing is not working. It's the idle's all off, and then it runs for a little bit, really, really choppy, and then it shuts, the whole thing shuts off. And I have a history in motorcycle mechanics. I'm actually a certified motorcycle repair technician. It's always exciting to say that. And I know how to work on small motors and carburetors and whatnot. And so I'm like, okay, this sounds like a fuel problem to me. It's, not getting fuel. And I thought at first, well, there's probably ice in the line. It's clogging it. And so I did, check the gas line, and I checked all the other stuff and put some gasoline antifreeze in it. And, all the stuff. And I was like, okay, no, that's not it. Maybe the carburetor's clogged. So I took the carburetor completely apart, checked everything, all the jets, everything's clear. Did all these diagnostic tests, and I'm like, I got sermons to do. I got like ministry stuff. I got people that are waiting for me to write to them. I'm just like, I don't have time to fix this. The Honda snowblowers are like the best ones out there, in many ways. And so I'm like, I can't believe this. The thing's still not running. I just had to give up. I'm like, I got to get back to ministry stuff. So that has been an issue. And then here recently, our main vehicle, we have a Chevy Tracker, an older one, 2004. It's got like, we bought it with 130 some thousand miles on it. Runs real great and everything else. And it has issues now. And so it's sitting. Well, my truck is sitting out here, and then I have a work truck as well that I bought not long ago, and that thing, I had it parked in the backyard. So we have about 3 to 4 feet of snow here right now, and we get the snow, it'll be light and fluffy, and then you get a little bit of, it'll warm up or rain a little bit. Like we had rain in December, and it froze everything, so you get like this soft and then really hard, like ice, and then a little bit harder and then soft, and then you get this weird combination of snow. So can't dig out my work truck. But my other pickup truck, and these are older vehicles too, by the way. Most of them are actually considered classic vehicles because they're more than 20 years old. So my old truck, my 79 Ford, which I've showed in some of the other videos and things, it's sitting out front, and they're plowing all the stuff from the street, and it's like plowed in totally. It's snow's like up to about here on me. And so it took me a couple days of digging out on the sides, and I have to be careful digging out because I don't want to run the shovel into the side of the truck and the whole deal. And got the thing started, and it's only two-wheel drive, and I can't get it out of the thing. It's like really stuck bad, so I'm either gonna have to dig the whole way out around the front of it, try to get something under the front of the truck and whatever else. So literally we are like in this weird situation now where I had to order parts for the tracker, and I'm waiting for the parts, and it's like literally we're like, you know, I gotta go to the store, we're starting to run low on groceries, and I'm going like, and you know, the whole time it's like I'm doing my ministry on, you know, along with all this stuff, and I'm just like pulling my hair out because I'm going like, there's so much Lord has showed me. I've been recording video now for the last, you know, 2 or 3 hours. This is the last one I'm doing, but it's just like there's all this stuff Lord showed me, and I want to bring it out and I want to answer people. I got letters stacking up and I got emails and all this other stuff, and it's this hindering thing. So it's just like, you know, and there's like so much more I could get done if these hindrances. I mean, I understand there's routine maintenance. I understand that there's things that you have to do. That's fine. But it's just like every single time it seems like I got some hardcore thing to bring out. It's like this, like the devil attacks and I get hindered from doing my work. So my emotions have not been real great at this time. It's just been kind of a down thing because, of, you know, when you... you're dealing with vehicles, you're like, okay, I try to fix this. No, it's not that. You know? So I spent a couple hours doing this, and I spent a couple hours trying that. And okay, I got to dig out the truck, so that's more time. And the whole time I'm like, yeah, I got to get back to my ministry. You know, so it's been tough. And unfortunately, what starts to happen is you start to kind of lose sight of the blessed hope. You know, there's always the thing there, boy, I wish the rapture had happened soon, I'd get out of here. But my love for seeing the Lord return has really started to diminish. And I've been having to focus my mind a lot on worldly things. And you know, because of a lot of the just getting really down and stuff of things going through, you know, whatever, I start to kind of look at things of the world a little bit just to kind of ease my mind a little bit. And I start thinking, you know, let's do some snowshoeing, which, I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with loving the things of that the Lord has created in nature. But you don't want to worship, and, you know, not worship so much, but you don't want to love that stuff too much where you don't want to leave it, you know. And it's just like, I'm thinking about dreams that I've always had and goals I've had for life. And I'm like, it kind of gets me excited again. And, you know, and it's like, you know, I get excited about the Lord and excited about truth, but it's just this struggle. The struggle that's there when you're in full-time ministry. And, you know, this is my 10th year being in ministry, so it's been a lot. But I'm going to talk about this thing of maintaining the blessed hope. So turn to Titus chapter 2 in your King James Bible. Just wanted to kind of put that in there because I wanted to, you know, what we're going through right now, because I know a lot of you, I hear from you, and you're going through some really rough stuff. We can relate. Don't think to yourself that, man, you know, if I become a full-time in Christian ministry and love the Lord and really doing a lot for the Lord and stuff, there's going to be all these blessings that come, and there are, that's there, but then it will never be attacked. No, you're going to have those attacks. And in the midst of all this thing too, by the way, even though my spirit has been really down, I get really kind of depressed and whatever, there's times that we're just having a great time. We're running around the house, you know, laughing and stuff, chasing, my wife and I are chasing our son around, and we're just, you know, having a ball, and we're singing hymns and things. Joy is always going to be there for a Christian. You know, in spite of, you might go through some rough times, but Titus chapter 2, verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. Sorry to the Calvinists. Salvation is available to anybody. There's no elect and non-elect in God's system. In terms of right now for Christians. Verse 12, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Say a whole lot about that. We'll get back to that. Verse 13, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee. Yeah. this is as much a rebuke of you out there as it is of myself. I have been taking my eyes off of Jesus and his return. And I've been praying a lot about that and just saying, Lord, I want that joy back. I want that expectation back of the excitement and everything else. And I don't want to, you know, I look at the world condition right now and I'm just like, you know, we're like right on the doorstep of World War III. I mean, it's just the two-state solution is in the news like all the time. This thing of we need to have two different states, you know, within Israel, the land over there. And they say, well, the land of Palestine, and it's the land of Israel. Give me a break. But, you know, you can kind of get sidetracked and you kind of start thinking, you know, well, you know, we can get this done in the spring and, you know, maybe look about another property or look about this or look about that. Or I'm like looking at my vehicle situation right now going, okay, should I kind of restructure? Maybe I'll sell the one old truck and try to get a different truck. You know, I'm thinking this stuff because it's just part of life. And you can get kind of pulled off, though. And I know I have a lot of dreams about having a garden someday and having animals and you know, other children and things, and, you know, and just, I have all these dreams, and sometimes I'll set my affections on that stuff, and my desire to see the Lord kind of cools off a little bit, and I mean really see the Lord. I'm not just talking escapism, just like, oh man, I can't wait to get out of here. That's there, but what I'm saying is really, truly having that love there, which is so important. So this is a rebuke, a soft, gentle rebuke, if you will, of those out there, I include myself, you know, that struggle with this thing of wanting to see the Lord. The Bible says there in verse 12, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, deny those things. If the Lord blesses you with certain things and you can grow your own food and raise an animal and have children and enjoy, you know, going kayaking or bicycling in the woods or hiking or camping or fishing or hunting or whatever you do, that's great. But don't let that overtake your love for the Lord. Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Okay? All that stuff comes from separation, right? You're not going to be able to do very much for the Lord if you're really drawn into the world and looking like the world, acting like the world, listening to the world's music, whatever else. You need to be separate, you know. And you go out there into the world and you hear the dirty jokes of the world and you hear the rock music and whatever else, and you need to live soberly and say, you know what, that's offensive to me. You know, I don't need to laugh at those jokes. I don't need to do this. I don't need to be this worldly stuff like that. I'm going to live soberly, righteously, and godly. People should see the Lord through your life. And when you do those things, it's going to help you to stay focused on the rapture, which is the blessed hope there. Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. That right there is something that should inspire that love, understanding how he died. You know, and you just go, oh yeah, I remember he died on the cross. Do you really think about that? I mean, the time of reflecting, of communion, doing things, you know, this doing remembrance of me, you're doing that, you know, you're showing the Lord's death until he come, the Bible talks about. Understanding, remembering what suffering Jesus did on the cross. And you think to yourself, what would that have been like? What would it have been like to be mocked and spit on and that pain that he went through, and just, oh, wow, and he did it all for me? And all I had to do is just come to him as a sinner, admit to who I am, and I get to exchange my wicked life for his righteousness? Wow, it's amazing. Don't you want to meet him? See, I mean, yeah, escape the world, that's great. But actually see him face to face for the first time ever? I mean, looking over there and you say, there he is. And now all the weird images of the Catholic paintings and stuff like this, of this sissy guy with long hair and he's knocking at the door gently and all that stuff's gone. And you go, that's what he looks like. I mean, did you ever get that thing? You know, you meet somebody online and stuff at first, it's just emailing back and forth, and you create a mental image in your mind. You imagine what they look like, you know? And that's how I first met my wife, and I was thinking, like, I know how this is going to be. You know, I've had this thing happen before. You know, I get some woman, and she writes and asks me questions about the Bible or whatever, and it's like she's probably like 75 years old or something, and like married with, you know, 30 grandchildren or something like this. So I was thinking about my wife, you know, when she first started writing to me. And then, like, you know, I all know she's not, you know, 75 with 30 grandchildren, and she's, you know, younger than I am. And you know, I was like, you know, I wonder if she's married, you know, and then, oh, she's single. And then, you know, and then the first time I saw her picture, I was like, oh, okay, wow, you know, and it went from there. But, you know, you form a mental image sometimes. And it's just like, you know, we all have mental images in our minds of what Jesus Christ looks like. But to have it actually happen and the rapture. And there he is. Jesus Christ, the one who died for me. And you look over at him and you say, thank you. I mean, there's a lot of you out there that have supported this ministry, and you've said nice things about this ministry and encouraged me just at the times I needed it. And I'd love to be able to meet you face to face and actually walk up to you and say, thank you. You don't know how much that meant to me. We're going to get to do that with Jesus Christ one day. Except, you know, we're not going to be shaking his hand. It's going to be more like bowing down before our King, which I look forward to. Yeah. It's going to be great. Turn next to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 4. I've been over these scriptures many, many times, but I'll tell you what, it's just so important to go over this again and again and again. These are our marching orders, so to speak. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Compare that over there to Titus chapter 2. Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. Very true of the day. Obviously, I don't need to tell any of you of that. We all experience it. Verse 5, but watch thou in all things, looking for the blessed hope. Watch thou in all things. Endure afflictions. Yeah. Do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of thy ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Yeah, we need to love the appearing of Jesus Christ. You know, and again, it's just like you see all these elements of Titus chapter 2. They're the verses that we read, you know, verses 11 down through. It's pretty incredible. But you know, I think a lot of us are getting to that point where we're saying, you know what? I am now ready to be offered. The time of my departure is at hand. You may not be able to say you fought a good fight, but I think we're very, very, very close to finishing our course. And fighting the good fight and keeping the faith, that's what we have to do. We don't have to convince everybody out there that we meet. You know, we don't have to win them all to Christ and stuff, just that no matter what the cost, you know, no matter what you have to do, just get them in, get them to make that decision. No, you don't have to do that. Absolutely not. We're ambassadors for Jesus Christ. We're ministers of reconciliation. But you go up to people, the average person today, they don't want anything to do with the Lord. I mean, we are literally, I mean, I just got to say this real quick. I mean, it just seems almost like we're dealing with a totally different, I hate to use this term, but like a different species of people. You know, it's just like these people, I'm like walking around in public going, I can't relate to these people on almost anything anymore. I mean, it's like really, really bad. You know, I'm just, it's weird. you know, and I watch things and updates, prophecy type updates type stuff, and talking about artificial intelligence, and we're going to gene splice this, and we're, you know, that, and what, and I'm just going like, what, you know, people think this is actually going to work, you know, man's been a consistent failure, but he's going to succeed at creating robots that can, you know, take over the world and whatever. Yeah, I don't think so. But again, you see the importance of loving the appearing of Jesus Christ. Maintaining that blessed hope. Understanding no matter how bad things get, the rapture is coming soon. Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 10 through 14. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. Tremendous scripture there to prove a pre-time of Jacob's trouble catching away. Verse 11, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ. In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. You're paid for. Okay? You're sealed. You know, you don't have to worry about this whole, well, what if this bad stuff happens? We're more than conquerors. We've already won. You know, God, you know, you're sealed. I mean, he's got your name written down in the book of life. Understand that. You know, I mean, there's all kinds of things that can be very unpredictable. You know, I mean, we bought vehicles and was like, hey, cool, this will be great. This is a good winter vehicle and stuff like that. Bought a snowblower. Hey, this is going to be wonderful. This will help out this year. I'll be able to do lane really quickly. And both of them failed. And I got to go out and fix things and work on things. And I don't even know. I mean, it could be that the motor, you know, is shot. I mean, it has compression and whatever else. But, you know, in the snowblower, I have no idea. You know, I got to work on the thing. I have no idea. But the point is, it's just like things on earth will fail. But we have a promise right here from the Lord himself. You're sealed until the day of redemption. And you are the purchased possession. Okay, so the Lord's not going to just allow his purchased possession to sit here and be destroyed. I want to show you a couple other interesting scriptures. John chapter 11. Came across this the other morning. We're reading through the book of John right now in our morning devotions. And this one was pretty interesting. I thought this was kind of a interesting thing here. John chapter 11, verse 1. Now a certain man was sick, named Lazarus, of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sisters sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. Do you feel like you're sick sometimes, Christian? I mean mentally sick. You say, brother, we shouldn't talk. Just bear with me for a minute. Have there been times when you felt like you're almost going into a state of anxiety where you're just like, I don't even know what's going on. Things are getting bad. I'm just like, I can't get out of this depression. I'm just like, Lord, I'm just praying, just like fervently praying. Going, Lord, please help me. I don't want to think these thoughts. I don't want to, you know, and you go to sleep at night and you sleep good, but you have weird dreams all night long or you're just fighting with depression and you're just like, I don't understand what's wrong. I'm so sick of this world. So everything's going to work out fine. You're like, we're heading into World War III for crying out loud. What do you mean everything's going to be fine? You know, man is the measure of all things. We're going to heal, you know, we're going to heal the diseases. We're going to bring back the economy. We're going to have, no, we're not. I can see what's going on, you know. I mean, you know, I just saw that there's this huge big tropical storm heading towards California. They're calling it Tropical Storm Lucifer, for crying out loud. Tropical Storm Lucifer heading towards the northern part of California where you have the Oroville, town of Oroville and the big dam and things there and stuff. And this thing is the biggest, man-made dam in America. And it's like the thing spills, it's going to like wipe out thousands and thousands of people, But things are getting better. Don't worry, Southern California sinkholes opening up, cars falling down into the sinkholes, and fire truck. I was watching here, and the fire trucks down onto, highways crumbling, and a fire truck falls down in the hole. But things are getting better. Yeah, so things are looking up. Well, for a Christian, we are looking up. But we're getting sick of this world. It's really starting to get rather sickening. You go to the grocery store, and you like walk around. You're going, okay, like 99% of the food here is toxic. It's got MSG in it, or high fructose corn syrup, or this or that, or and you're just going like, I can't eat food. There's rock music playing on the loudspeakers. There's, all this weird stuff. Are you sick of the world, Christian? Verse 4. When Jesus heard that, he said, "This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby." Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. When he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. One day is with the Lord is 1,000 years. 2 Peter chapter 3. It's essentially right around 2 days. Could the Lord have come back for the first century Christians? Were they sick of the world back then? We just read it. Paul's saying, I've finished my course. I've kept the faith, I'm ready to be offered. Let's go. Let's get out of here. He was sick of it. He was sick of his life back then. I mean, back then in the first century when they weren't dealing with all the stuff that we deal with today, all the toxicity that we live under and things. I mean, we don't even know what the real world was like. I mean, if you're, maybe if you're in your 70s or 80s, you might remember, before geoengineering and GMO and all the other toxicity and stuff out there, all the electronic smog and everything else. Even there, I mean, you still had radio waves, television waves, and things like that. I mean, none of us really know what the world was like. We never experienced the first century world. And yet Paul back then was saying, I'm ready to be offered. I have a desire, to depart. Talked about, for to me live is Christ and to die is gain. The Lord could have come back then. They were sick of the world. But the Lord waited for essentially 2 days. And a lot of times you get to looking at this world and you say, man, I'm so sick and tired of this world. Lord, what on earth are you waiting for? I just don't understand it. I'm just sick. Just, Lord, aren't you coming? What's he waiting for? The sickness is not unto death. You can make it. He'll provide a way out when you go through these temptations. The worst trials that you go through, the worst trials I've been through, I mean, I've been through some rough stuff, brethren. And it's just like the Lord gets us through it. I've seen it. And the Lord oftentimes will bless you when you go through a rough trial. He'll do some kind of amazing thing and you're just going to be like, wow, thank you, Lord. He'll get you through it. The sickness that you have, the sickness of this world, where you're just going, I'm so sick and tired of it, it's not unto death. All right? What we go through in this life is not going to kill you. But for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Do you realize what the rapture is? The rapture is the body of Christ leaving. You say, well, yeah, brother, I understand. Think about it. Think about it for a minute. All the debates, who's saved, who's lost, whose gospel's right, whose belief's right, who blah, 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 blah. It's all over at the rapture. The body of Christ is gone. We're part of his body. We're seated together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus right now. It's all over. The rapture. There is no more debate. Absent from the body. Well, actually, not absent from the body, excuse me. That's what dead saints are right now, absent from the body, present with the Lord. With us, our whole body's going. We're going up. The Lord's going to get glory for that. Right now, the sicker we get of this world, and the more this world just becomes a disgusting place, that separation between saved and lost is getting so great. You know, and I mean, I can testify to the fact I've seen this thing so many times. I've been like, I went into ministry way back when, and I was like, man, you know, there's like a lot of good Christians out there. And as time is going on, I'm like watching people and they're doing stuff, and I'm going, wait a second. I'm going to get people like, did you see brother so-and-so? Did you see what they're doing now? What they're saying? They're like totally into heresy. And you're just going like, I don't know if they're even saved. I thought they were way back when. I mean, tell you how much grace I have. Way back when I first got into ministry, I thought Steven Anderson was saved. Okay? I mean, he was just like really doing the Baptist thing back in those years. I thought he was a Christian. You know? People say, oh, you judge people. I thought the guy was saved. I had grace enough to think that he was saved and just messed up doctrinally. And he has done his very best to prove over the years that he is most definitely lost. So thank you to Steven Anderson and all of your little loyal followers there for convincing me that you're actually all completely lost and on your way to hell. Ken Hovind, another good example. I thought very highly of Ken Hovind. Now I'm like seeing one thing after another. The guy's pride and just, you know, divorces his wife. Oh, she left him and stuff. Okay, then what are you doing getting married to a woman that's divorced? You know? And then his vow of poverty and his ecumenical agenda and all this other stuff. And I'm just going like, what in the world? What's going on? Well, as we get more and more sick of the world, the separation happens more and more. So when the body of Christ finally does leave, I think we're going to be like, yeah, I know that, you know, brother and so-and-so and whatever else, they were saved, yeah. Because they didn't go along with this whole system, this whole, all these different systems that lead back to Catholicism, you know. It's really something. John chapter 3. I'll show you another thing that's happening right now. John chapter 3. Verse 29. Okay, we have John the Baptist speaking here. He says, he that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom, which standeth and heareth him, rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. This my joy therefore is fulfilled. He must increase, but I must decrease. What do you have? You have the Old Testament saints decreasing. And the New Testament, he sees Jesus Christ and he says, there's the New Testament. The bridegroom, he's here. He's here. What are you there, John the Baptist? I'm a friend of the bridegroom. You mean you're not part of the bride? Nope. John, you know, I think prophetically he was prophesying the fact that he was going to die before the New Testament came in. New Testament comes in with the death of the testator, Hebrews chapter 9. You can read about that. Jesus Christ brings in the New Testament when he dies on the cross. Okay. You know, it's not when the, you know, you can make the thing, well, the church started in Acts chapter 2 and all, you know, yeah, I understand that. And then the gospel is revealed to Paul. I got it. Okay. But the point is, John the Baptist, he's there as an Old Testament saint and he's looking and he's saying, I'm decreasing right now. See, every time there's a major dispensational, or there's a dispensational shift, there's a change that happens. And right now, brethren, we're in that dispensational shift. That's why we feel our influence is decreasing. We're starting to go less and less and less. And I thank the Lord there's people getting saved. There's, you know, you'll still have personal revival. Absolutely. Sure. You're still going to see things from the Lord. The Lord's going to still be there. He's going to bless you. That's great. But what I'm saying is we're seeing the world getting worse and worse and worse. But yet, he that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom, which standeth and heareth him, rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. He's looking and he's seeing Jesus Christ and he's going, New Testament coming in. Wow, this is great. I can't believe, man, this is neat. We as Christians today can look into the future and we can say, hey, look at that. Look at all that attention on Israel over there, the two-state solution and all this other stuff that's happening. And look at that. They're going to build move the embassy, you know, is it the embassy? I think it's the embassy. From Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, you know, the American embassy and things. Look at that. And they're going to fight and all this. Wow, this prophecy being fulfilled. We can look at the Jewish temple, the third temple, the plans for it to be rebuilt and all the preparations for the temple. We can look and we can say, wow, look at that. the church age is ending. We are decreasing. But those Jews are coming on the scene, aren't they? It's getting more and more and more attention. We're looking, we're going, the Lord's about ready to start dealing with those Jews. Yeah. Praise the Lord. See? We're going to be leaving. Finally, go back to the book of Jeremiah. Talking about the words blessed and hope. Jeremiah chapter 17. Jeremiah chapter 17, beginning in verse 7. Remember, we're to look for the blessed hope, the rapture. Jeremiah 17, verse 7. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, and whose hope the Lord is. Keep your eyes focused on Jesus Christ. You know, in the midst of suffering, in the midst of things going really, really bad, don't forget that the rapture is going to happen. Verse 8. For he shall be as a tree planted by the waters, and that spreadeth out her roots by the river, and shall not see when heat cometh, but her leaf shall be green, and shall not be careful in the year of drought, neither shall cease from yielding fruit. That's what it's all about, brethren. You're not going to bear much fruit for the Lord if you take your eyes off of Jesus Christ. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, and whose hope the Lord is. Jesus Christ is our hope. He is our blessed hope. And when we see Him face to face, I want to be able to look at my Savior and say, I never gave up hope waiting for you. It wasn't just about like, oh, I'm so sick and tired of this world. I'm so sick and tired of things, and I just can't stand this place anymore. Just get me out of here. Come on. I mean, that element's there. You know, Lazarus wasn't wrong for being sick, okay? But our main motivation should be love. It should be wanting to see the one who died for me. It's very important. All right. Just wrote a little list here. Why is the rapture called the blessed hope? I have 10 things here. First and foremost, as I've said, we will see Jesus face to face for the very first time. That's something that should cheer up your day. Number two, no more questions over who is saved and who's not. It's over. Doctrinal disputes are done. Number three, dead and living saints together forever. I mean, it's going to be extra cool to see a lot of you up there. I mean, some of you that write in the comments, you know, you're not saved. I mean, some of the people that write on these comments, feel bad for you, you know, and I see the viewers that have been, you know, the loyal viewers of this channel, and I see you back and forth with these Catholics and atheists and whatever else. They're not going, you know, they'll be staying, but, you know, those of you out there, my friends in the ministry and things, and I love you dearly. You've been there for me, and I know I've been there for you. I've been there to help a lot of you. We're going to see each other for the first time. And it's not going to be like, oh, you know, this is so great. You know, just, oh, man, I wish we had more time. You know, I just, it's only like, what, 15 minutes. Boy, that time went by so fast. No, we're there for eternity. There ain't going to be any kind of, well, you know, I got to get back to work soon, but it was so nice to see you. Nope. Together forever. But how about those dead saints? We're going to be up there hugging and stuff and jumping up and down. This is great. Hey, you know, and stuff like this. And all of a sudden you're going to look over and there's this guy and everything. You go, D.L. Moody. And he'll look over and he'll say, Brian Denlinger. Yeah, I know who you are. We'll know even as we're also known, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. So we're not going to be dumb bunnies going, I don't recognize you. You know, somebody comes up, do you know me? I'm not sure. We'll know. Okay, we'll know who the saints are, all right? And there's Paul over here, and there's Peter, and there's Mary. You go over and say, hey, Mary, how you doing? She'll say, oh, pretty good. Nice to see you, you know, and stuff. She's not going to be sitting on a throne above God, you know, or holding God in her arms saying, I'm the mother of God. That's not the Mary of the Bible. She's just a Christian, just another Christian like other Christians like I am and like a lot of you out there. as the Catholics fall on the floor and go into convulsions, you know, ever hearing that. It's okay. I want them to feel, you know, anyways. Number four, no more pain. And no worries about, worries about death. I know we're not to fear death, but I'm saying, you know, obviously you don't walk across the highway blindfolded, you know, because you think I might get killed and it might be kind of painful. You know, rapture happens? No. You know, I remember it was something that really brought me to tears. You know, I heard Dr. Peter S. Ruckman, you know, he was like, did one of his last sermons, and he was, you know, his old voice, shaking voice, and he started to get kind of teary, and he said, I sure wish the Lord would come. I know why he said that, because he wanted to experience the rapture. That's what he wanted. And that should be all of our hopes. You know, go up, never have to experience death. And when we do go up, that fear is gone. How about no more temptation and sin? Over. The flesh becomes redeemed. Redemption of the purchased possession. You get up there, wow. All of a sudden my mind is pure. No more thoughts of evil. Wow. Can you imagine that? I mean, that's exciting. That's very exciting. No more taxes or bills to pay. No more need to have a job. No more money problems. We're going to be living in a city of gold, you know, precious stones all over the place. God of heaven providing our needs. Working for Him. Number seven, God's justice comes to the earth. There's so much evil, so much wickedness right now. So many people just mocking the Lord, just spitting on the Lord, just mocking this book, this blessed book. Just when you think about what Jesus Christ, how He died on the cross, and then to have people make fun of that. I mean, you could make fun of me. You can come up and punch me in the face or spit in my face or whatever else. But don't mess with the book. Don't mess with the Lord Jesus Christ. My word. When we leave, the Lord doesn't have to go, oh, wait, yeah, I'm not going to destroy that city. There's some Christians living in there, so yeah, I want to bless them. And nope, we're getting pulled out up at the rapture. The Lord says, okay, time for judgment. Noah goes into the ark with his family and the animals and things that God decided to save. And the Lord says, okay, He seals up the door, time for judgment. That's the first worldwide judgment. The time of Jacob's trouble is the second one. And the second one, first one was 40 days, 40 nights. The second one is 7 years. God's angry. He's very angry. And He is rightfully angry. Number eight. Judgment seat of Christ. A lot of Christians say, well, boy, that's going to be a fearful time because we're going to see a lot of our works burned up and things like that. Well, in a sense, but you know what? Just being there and just, you know, having the God of heaven say, yeah, you know, hey, you did good here and you did good there and you tried and things and whatever. That's going to be great. I mean, if you make it the whole way through the judgment seat of Christ and you still come out with no rewards and you've just kind of messed up your life, well, that's a bad thing, but at least you're saved. You know, it's a great thing to look forward to. Marriage supper of the Lamb. All right. We get married in heaven, come back down. Lord whips the Antichrist's army, shows off for His new bride, you know. And then we go to Jerusalem. We have the judgment of the nations. We go out and gather the people for judgment, bring them there. Lord sets the sheep on His right hand, the goats on the left, go down into hell. And He says, all right, let's get to work. Let's start planting the gardens. Lord goes and restores this earth back to like the Garden of Eden, is what I believe. It's going to be a pretty good time. And of course, the Millennial Kingdom. Here, ruling and reigning with Christ for 1,000 years. So it isn't just, you know, well, the rapture happens and up we go and then we're eternity in heaven. Uh-uh. We're up there for just a short time and we come back down on the earth. We're here for 1,000 years. I mean, put that in perspective for a minute. Can you imagine what all you would have seen and experienced if you had been born in 1017 and here you are 1,000 years later? Can you imagine how the world would have changed and how all the stuff that you would have experienced in 1,000 years of life? And that's with the wicked, horrible, you know, kingdoms and murdering, death, and whatever else. How about 1,000 years of Jesus Christ ruling and reigning on the earth? Number 9. This kind of goes in with number 7, God's justice comes to the earth, but there won't be any more Jesuits or Illuminati or Council on Foreign Relations or the Masonic Lodge or Catholicism or Islam or whatever. All done. It isn't like, you know, we'll get down here, you know, and to the millennial kingdom and all of a sudden it's like, oh, man, you know, some of the saints over in, you know, that part of the world over there, they just got taken over. There was a military coup and, oh, man, we're going to have to go to war with that nation. No, no. Jesus Christ ruling and reigning for 1,000 years and we're out there dictating his laws for the people to follow. All the idols, you know, names of the idols and things are all cut off. It's all over. Going to be great. And finally, number 10, Earth is going to be supernaturally restored. All right? Another big one. I mean, I believe firmly that 50 years, you know, no more than 50 years from now, we're all going to be back down here on the Earth, those of us that are saved. And, you know, I'm not going to give it exact, I could probably shorten it down a lot more than that, but I'll just, 50 years, just to play it safe. We'll be back here on the earth, walking around on this planet and looking and saying, boy, it's such a nice day. Boy, I remember back when I was on the earth, didn't look like this, but it was a cesspool. I thought it was good back then. Boy, it's sure good now. I was up in heaven there for 7 years, and during the time of Jacob's trouble, I was up there, and boy, heaven is incredible. You know, it's amazing. But I come back down here to the earth. We're going to be here for another however many years, 900 something years. And this will work. You know, we're getting close, brethren. And well, you got to, you know, the crown of righteousness that is offered there in 2 Timothy chapter 4, it's conditional. And that crown is only given to those who love the appearing of Jesus Christ. You start to get your eyes off of, out of focus, and I'm not even talking about going post-trib or something like that, you know. There are people that get shaken up by the post-trib system and they kind of start to lose faith a little bit. I'm talking about people that believe in, you know, the pre-time of Jacob's trouble catching away, and yet things get so rough and you start to go through the depression and you go through the trials and the tribulation as the body of Christ, as the church age is decreasing, and it's just like things are getting so bad, and it's just like you get so down and you take your eyes off of Jesus Christ and you just get totally worldly. That can happen, brethren. And if you do, you're going to miss the crown of righteousness. Always keep your love for seeing Jesus Christ at the forefront. There should be nothing between you and the Lord. You know, the Bible teaches that there's one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. And you think, well, that's, yeah, we got to pray to the Lord. But that also works, too, in another way, and that is there shouldn't be anybody between you and the Lord. Not your wife, not your children. No one deserves to be in that position between you and the Lord. So, I hope that this was a challenge to some of you out there that are kind of starting to lose some faith and starting to get down. I mean, it's happening to Christians all over the world. We're feeling it. We are feeling that decrease. We are feeling that sickness, so to speak. We're feeling it. And not much longer to go. So let's close with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, I really do thank you for these precious promises that we have, that we're going to see you one day soon, face to face. And I just pray, Lord, that you would help each of us to get through these times. It's very rough, Lord. We are very sick. And I just really do pray that you would please keep us busy, Lord. Help us to be trusting in you so that we'll be like that tree by the water courses, that our roots go down deep and we trust in your word, and we're able to bear a lot of fruit right up until the time that you catch us away. That's my prayer, Lord, not only for myself, but for all my brothers and sisters in Christ, that you'd help us to be good fruit-bearing Christians so that we can bring you glory, not for our own glory, Lord, but for your glory, so that when we leave at the rapture, people that know us, acquaintances of all kinds, will say, I know why they left, because they were saved and I'm lost. That's why they left. That's my prayer, Lord, for all the people out there that are saved. And I just pray, Lord, that you would help us to stand by your word no matter what happens. And I ask it all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. All right. That is going to be it for this study. I'll probably be able to get back to the Revelation expository studies eventually, if I can get a vehicle that runs and things. Just please keep us in your prayers. You know that, I mean, things are looking up. I know what the problem is now, and so I should be able to fix it when the parts get here. And we do have a little store within walking distance, so it's not like we're going to starve or something like that, you know. But you know, it's frustrating to me. That's my greatest prayer request. If you want to know a good prayer request, that the Lord would just keep the doors open, and that we would not be hindered, because that's what gets to me. That's the thing that'll really tear me down. It's not personal attacks on me. It's not I'm feeling sick or whatever else. I mean, that's bad. But I'm just saying, what really, really upsets me in the ministry is when I'm like, okay, I got really important stuff to preach, or I got people to answer, or really important things. And it's just like stuff happens where I'm like, you got to be kidding me. This is going to take me a couple of days to do this thing. You know, that's what upsets me. So if you could pray for that, that the Lord would just keep things, our path cleared, so to speak, so we can get a lot of work done. There are some definite things coming up this year, 2017, that, you know, we're restructuring a lot of things and whatever else. Always trying to get more efficient, always trying to make, you know, our research efforts and our video efforts, you know, better. So we're praying about some different things. Again, that'll be for future updates and whatever else, but just really appreciate people's prayers for us, that the Lord would just protect us and just keep a lot of these roadblocks out of the way so we can stay efficient. So that is going to be it. Thank you very much for your prayers and your friendship. We do appreciate that.